campus. Albany talked about the problem and did nothing to fix it. They spent more than they had, and they stuck the people with the bill. Now, the debt is due. But talk is cheap, and New York is already too expensive for too many New Yorkers. We are here to find common ground and bipartisan solutions to the crisis we all face. And a fair, responsible, and bipartisan budget is the only thing that will get the job done. The Senate, we took the first step Monday with respect to our resolution, our budget resolution, made the smart cuts and tough choices New York can afford. We reduced the growth of spending in a reasonable, responsible manner. We held spending under the rate of inflation for just the third time in 30 years. We provided for the creation of good-paying jobs and attracts businesses through sound economic development. We provided $500 million in property tax relief to overburdened seniors who are being taxed out of their homes. We restored funding for the student MetroCard program so our children retain their access to a reliable and affordable means of mass transportation. And we fixed the flawed MTA payroll tax that placed an undue burden on small businesses and localities from mass transit hubs. We consolidated government to reduce costs, and we made it more efficient and effective. We protected our seniors, children, the disabled, most vulnerable residents who are disproportionately affected by the economic crisis. And we rejected, the use of $1.1 billion in new taxes to close the budget gap. These were not easy choices, but neither are the choices facing families across the state. New Yorkers are struggling to keep their jobs, pay their bills, and most of all, feed their families. The job before us is not easy, but we were elected to make the tough calls and the tough decisions. Leader Skelos, I want to thank you for the work that we did with respect to closing the deficit reduction last year and in bipartisan fashion. Throughout the budget process, our members have reached out to our colleagues across the aisle for their budgetary priorities, and we held 13 public hearings. Our communities didn't send us here to avoid the tough choices. They elected us to roll up our sleeves, take a seat at the table, and stand up for our communities. Party lines will not get our budget in line. We must put partisanship aside to give New Yorkers a budget that is reflective of low cost, low taxes, and attract businesses that create jobs. Together, we will definitely meet that challenge, deliver the change New Yorkers demand, and give our state the result it truly deserves. And we will start down that road today with all our colleagues, because we understand how important it is. And I truly want to thank my colleagues here in attendance, Deputy Majority Leader Jeff Klein, Vice Chair of Finance, Senator Liz Krueger, Vice President Pro Temp, David Valesky, and also Senator Skelos, and also the Deputy Minority Leader, Senator Livers. Thank you. Speaker.
Thank you, Senator. Just one piece of housekeeping I think we ought to do. We have, and everybody has here, the copy of the guidelines for conference committee process, which are the guidelines that we have had in effect for a number of years. And if there is no objection, I would like to have these incorporated into the rules by which we go with conference committees. Without objection?
No objection.
Okay. So, Senator, I am pleased to join you in convening this initial meeting of the General Budget Conference Committee. Delighted to be joined by the chair of our Ways and Means Committee, Assemblyman Denny Farrell, Ron Canestrieri, our Majority Leader, Deputy Speaker Earlene Hooper, and Speaker Pro Tem Peter Rivera, as well as the Minority Leader, Brian Kolb, and the Ranking Member of the Ways and Means Committee, Assemblyman Hayes. Clearly, there's no panacea for the challenge that we face. We have two approaches to the 2010-2011 budget that is before us. Speaking for the Assembly majority, we made difficult choices. In order to close the $9.2 billion budget gap and keep the state of New York on the road to recovery, we made difficult spending cuts, $4.3 billion worth, including $883 million in education cuts and $700 million in Medicaid and health savings. We propose critical budget reforms while protecting programs and services New York's working families depend on, and we rejected $1 billion in proposed taxes and fees, including the so-called soda tax. As our plan clearly indicates, we're committed to mitigating some of the governor's overly harsh cuts. Frankly, we do not believe that we should be balancing the budget on the backs of families by slashing their TAP awards or by charging a fee to parents for early intervention services for their children with special needs or to people who require ambulance service. In our plan, we restore $600 million of the governor's proposed school aid cut, a restoration that we insist on because we believe our public schools cannot sustain a $1.4 billion year-over-year cut without an extremely negative impact on our classrooms and on our local property taxpayers. We reduce the governor's health care cuts. We reject the governor's base aid cut to our public community colleges. And like the Senate, we avert the closure of 91 state parks and historic sites, which are important sources of tourism and revenue to the state. In this budget, the Assembly has joined the governor in what we believe is a critical health care reform by reinstating the requirement that the health insurance companies obtain prior approval from the state insurance department before increasing premiums on certain ratepayers. In addition to responsible spending cuts, we propose significant agency consolidations that will save taxpayers $32 million this year. We also put forward a major local fiscal relief plan for the state to take over the cost of localities in administering Medicaid. Our proposal is modeled off what we accomplished collectively in 2005 when we capped Medicaid spending growth for localities. This bold proposal will save local taxpayers more than $300 million a year when fully implemented. As you know, we accepted the framework of the sweeping and historic budget reforms proposed by the Lieutenant Governor specifically to eliminate the structural deficit over a five-year period by moving to gap accounting and the establishment of a review board that will trigger a serious process for the reductions of any deficit. These reforms will provide fiscal stability as we come out of the worst economic downturn this nation has seen since the Great Depression. Right now, the Division of the Budget is evaluating the Assembly and the Senate proposals. We need to come to an agreement with the governor on the overall financial plan in order to move this process forward. It is the only responsible way to proceed. Given the way the governor submitted his budget, we need him to resubmit and therefore be an active player in the process. Once the governor has accepted the framework, we can quickly move ahead with this open public and transparent joint conference committee process. I will be here in Albany this weekend and have scheduled conferences for both Saturday and Sunday. That said, the Assembly majority is committed to engaging in meaningful negotiations with our colleagues, both in the Senate and with the governor, to address the significant challenges facing this state. Thank you, Senator.
Thank you very much, Speaker. I'd like to call on Senator Skelos.
Thank you, Senator Sampson. Appreciate the opportunity to finally participate in the Joint Conference Committee. As you know, under the rules of the deficit of the Budget Reform Act of 2007, these committees should have been constituted 10 days after the governor, as he did, submitted his budget. Just a couple of questions, really, in terms of form and then perhaps in terms of substance. I'd like to...
Speak into the mic a little closer.
You can't hear me?
There. Great.
I would like to ask Leader Sampson, under the rules of the Senate that were adopted last year, the reform rules, when it comes to committee composition, there is supposed to be proportional representation, which would mean at this meeting there should be five Democrat members and four Republican members. As I indicated to you in the letter today, is it your intention that we will not be able to have the proportional representation on this committee as required by the rules?
With all due respect, Senator Skelos, the rules that you're quoting for are for standing committees, not joint committees.
So it does not apply to this committee. Proportional representation does not apply. Okay.
Like I said, once again,
we would beg to differ, but
that applies
we can
standing,
continue
not joint committees.
Since that reform goes out the window.
Thank you.
I'd like to, just in terms of scheduling, it's my understanding that the Assembly, either now or at some point this evening, is passing extender bills with messages of necessity from the governor. Mr. Speaker, is that going to occur tonight, or is it happening now?
We will have an emergency extender on the floor of the Assembly this evening. I would presume that there are sufficient numbers of the Assembly who will want government to continue and workers to receive their paychecks in a timely fashion next week. And regardless of what we do with an overall budget, this is necessary so that checks can be printed and mailed and direct deposits be made as early as Monday.
I mean, my question, then the answer
that.
Is that the Assembly I would assume has received that there the bills. Are enough. And they will be passed tonight with messages of necessity.
I would assume there are enough votes to pass them. I cannot assure you that they'll pass until those votes are recorded.
Okay. I'd like to ask Leader Sampson whether the Senate will be bringing up the extenders with the messages as passed by the Assembly this evening, so that the Senate can vote on those extenders.
I think, as I instructed to you earlier, Senator Skelos, the deadline is April 1st. Today is the, I think, 26th of March. As I indicated, on Monday at 9 a.m., there will be session in which we will deal with those extenders.
So that's your intention now, that these would be voted on it at 9 a.m. on Monday morning?
Yes, Senator Skelos.
Okay. Even if the Assembly passes them this evening?
That's correct, Senator Skelos. Once again, as I indicated, and I think everyone knows, our deadline is April 1st. We will be here this weekend. Tomorrow, our conference will be together to discuss the revenue and other fiscal issues so we can make sure that we have that financial plan, but most of all, that framework, so we can continue our work with respect to our tables at the conference committees.
If I could ask a follow-up question to that, and certainly our conference is agreeable, and obviously it's necessary that we work, you know, through the weekend, into next week if necessary, respecting holidays. Will there be a schedule of joint conference committee meetings, Senate and Assembly, put forth this evening so that members will be able to know what committees they're on, joint conference committees they're on, so that we can prepare to have a transparent, open, and frank discussion as to the differences between the Senate and the Assembly bills, and get to a resolution so that there can be an on-time budget on April 1st.
Senator Skelos, I'm always for a transparent, open, and a frank discussion with respect to this. As I indicated, we will be in a conference this weekend. We will be discussing our financial plan, which we also have to deal with the second floor. A framework will be set up. Conference committees will be conducted in a transparent and open, so we can have a frank discussion, so everyone can sit at this table and see what programs we're advocating to cut.
My concern is, and certainly of our Republican conference, is that that the process, number one, that has been violated up to this point, the people of the state of New York deserve joint conference committees starting immediately with the Senate and the Assembly. And I guess my question then would be to the Speaker, will you be putting out a schedule of joint conference committees starting tomorrow, since the Senate will be here, so that we can proceed with your members, Senate members, and I assume all the members of the Senate and the Assembly here, so that we can proceed with joint conference committees?
Senator, as I indicated in my opening remarks, the important thing is to accept the fiscal framework so that we can proceed. I think the proposal by the Assembly and the proposal by the Assembly, by the Senate, are documents. They are part of the record of each House. They are available to anybody who asks for them. And so to rehash that in a conference committee setting in each individual area would be duplicative. The important thing is to narrow the differences in them, and that can only be done, as I said earlier, once there is a framework for a fiscal plan that is the governor is in agreement with. Once that occurs, I think it is imperative upon us to engage in what our subcommittee process by having the rank and file members of the legislature participate in discussions of the merits, the various merits of how the various appropriations or cuts would be made.
See, my concern is, you know, obviously, and really the taxpayers in the state, that last year's budget, when it was adopted behind closed doors, statements being that we didn't need Republicans to discuss the budget.
Can you move the mic?
We saw an increase in taxes and fees of over $8 billion, a payroll tax in the MTA region. All funds spending went from about $120 billion to $134 billion. And this year, it's my understanding that the governor has a spending plan of $136 billion, which is obviously a increase over last year. The Assembly has proposed $136.8 billion budget, which is an increase in spending. The Senate budget resolution, although a resolution was done, there was no financial plan with it, so it's very hard to estimate how high that would be, but I know there's $1.7 billion in adds to it. I would love to, I think there were also increases in taxes and fees and most of the plans or an increase in borrowing, increasing the debt. I would love to, so that everybody here can be brought up to date and understand how we're going to deal between the two resolutions, if Senator Sampson or Speaker Silver could really explain the differences between the two resolutions and why they think their resolution and their plan is better than the other.
Senator Scales, if I can just jump in and just be brief. First things first, one, it'd be great to go to these conference committees, and at that point in time, hopefully we will be able to see your plan, see where you intend to cut. We passed a resolution, which was 32-29, in which you rejected $1 billion that we said we were not going to tax or increase spending with respect to New Yorkers. You voted against to restore the STAR rebate checks to the seniors, also to restore TAP, also to save senior centers. I think this is what the public is talking about. We can go over and rehash with respect to what happened to last year, and I can go back to what happened over the last 10 years, 20 years. But I think if we're going to move forward, we need to move forward with a plan that is reflective of both our ideas and work the same way we worked last year with respect to the DRP. I think the people in the state of New York are tired of the blame game. As you indicated earlier this week, you talked about, once again, you're talking about the past. You know, you're talking about last year. Last year is last year. We're having a general conference committee. We're going to set up a framework and move forward at this point in time.
I guess my question is, I know that there have been meetings with you, the governor, and Speaker Silver at the mansion. So I'm just trying to get up to date and refreshed on perhaps what issues the two of you may have closed, at least between the two of you. And as we go into the joint conference committees, I have a letter that was sent to Governor Patterson by 16 of the Senate Democrats indicating that they would not support any cuts in aid to education. And the Senate resolution had over $1.2 billion in cuts to education. I believe the Assembly about $800 million. I guess my question is, and it's trying to figure out how you negotiate here, is if you have 16 senators that indicated that they could not in good conscience vote for the final budget that includes any cuts to education, whether that is any cuts or a non-starter for the Senate Democrats based upon, this letter, which was not going to read all the names, signed by Susie Oppenheimer and Breslin and a number of others. I'm just Stuart Cousins. Just wondering if that's a non-starter.
Senator Skelos, once again, we made the tough choices. Once again, I'm looking forward to your plan and see what cuts you propose. But going back again, once again, you know, we talk about property tax relief. We restored the STAR rebate checks, restored TAP, and in addition, we rejected $1.1 billion in new fees and new taxes. We made the tough choices. We have to continue to make the tough choices to move forward. Our conference made those tough choices. We established a framework in which to work in. The Assembly has established their framework. Hopefully with the conference committees, we will see your framework to see what cuts you proposed, if any, to education or health care or any other thing that had an impact on the budget. And we're looking forward to that.
I think that's what Senator Scalzo's point is. I'm not going to sit here and debate what both houses put in their budget. Certainly that was your prerogative. It came to the floor. But we're talking about process. And we can't put forward any of our suggestions or ideas if we don't start the process. Now, it's nice that we've started this committee, but Senator Scalzo has asked for a schedule of what time the various committees are going to start tomorrow And it appears from the answer that we've gotten that there are no committee meetings tomorrow. Sunday is considered a religious holiday for some people, so the question is whether there'll be meetings there. Certainly, Monday and Tuesday are also religious holidays. Then we're up against the 31st and the 1st. So, you know, while I don't want to sit here and debate what's in both House budgets, we'll have plenty of time to do that. What my constituents want, and Senator Sampson, you know, you're right, we have an opportunity here to be transparent, and that's our frustration. We're not being transparent. Because in order to be transparent in front of these cameras, you set up the conference committee schedule, and you begin the process of debating what's in the two House budgets, and at that point in time, you'll find whether or not the Senate Republicans have any ideas or don't have any ideas. But the people who I represent and people throughout the state are waiting. And you know, there was no conference committees last year. The law says that there has to be conference committees. That's not taking place. So my frustration is the process. And if there is no process, there's no transparency. And so for anybody to be able to present their proposal based on what both houses have passed, and I respect the fact that the leadership in both houses have done a budget resolution, but our frustration is, and my personal frustration is, that the process of transparency is not beginning. We're being bluffed here. This is a bluff. Until I see an actual meeting list, when the meetings are going to be set up, and when we'll sit in and debate the issues, this is a bluff.
I would just suggest to you, Senator, we are sitting and debating the issues. Otherwise, you wouldn't be at the microphone. But at this point, I think under the protocol we've always used, it is appropriate for the Assembly Minority Leader to have the opportunity to say something as well. Brian Cole?
If I could, just a couple of follow-up questions.
I thought you yielded the balance of your time to your colleague.
Sometimes resolutions are not that, you know, specific, and they need clarification. I'd like to ask Senator Sampson whether in the Democrat resolution there was a state spending cap.
Senator Skelos, if we're talking about a spending cap, which you have always been talking about, would have violated your own spending cap on all occasions, maybe except for one point in time. And I think, although I like the dialogue that we're having, I think, as we have indicated, I've indicated to you what subcommittees and what members on our subcommittees are for these conference committees. We are ready to move forward. We will be here this weekend. As I indicated, we're talking with respect to revenue tomorrow. At some point in time, we will work towards putting together not only a fiscal framework, a framework in which we can operate at these tables so we can effectually get something done. The deadline is quickly approaching, and I would like to get something done.
So that's a no?
Once again, Senator Skelos.
In your spending resolution, is there any property tax cap or circuit breaker property tax credit?
Once again, Senator Skelos, I think last week, Thursday, Senator Klein's bill, which included a property tax cap and other relief for homeowners throughout the state, was passed. I think it was passed 59-1. You know where our position is. You know what we believe, that we have to cut spending, we have to provide property tax relief, and most of all, we cannot no longer increase taxes and fees on people of the state of New York. So as I continue to tell you, I would love to work in a bipartisan fashion to get things done, and I look forward to getting things done.
Part of the I appreciate that, so I guess the answer is no to that. Because really it's the budget resolutions that we have to deal with. Within your plan, is there a STAR rebate checks for non-senior homeowners? That the STAR rebate check was the check that was eliminated last year in your budget.
What's the question, Senator Scales?
Is there a STAR rebate check for non-senior homeowners in your budget resolution?
Senator Scales, try to be brief as possible. On Monday, with respect to our resolution, all 29 of your members rejected STAR rebate checks that went to seniors.
So I'd assume that's an answer is no also. So thank you.
Assemblyman Kolb.
Well, good afternoon, everyone.
I got four reasons why I'd love to get this budget process going. First of all, the taxpayers are looking for it. Second, I've got a lousy head cold. Third, Syracuse lost, and fourth, Cornell lost. So I think the faster we get going, the better I'll feel.
Cornell got going pretty fast.
Yeah, they did. This weekend, the Assembly Republican Conference has been working on several weeks of different ideas, just like we did with the deficit reduction plan, in terms of ideas that we have on savings, possibly some revenue generators, obviously some restorations, and our budget staff and Jim Hayes, representing Ways and Means, will provide those to each of the conferences and the governor. Thing that we would like to do is get some feedback if these are bad ideas or good ideas, to try to generate some feedback through the legislative leaders and the governor and their staff, because we do have some other ideas. I think some of the things that have been talked about in the budget in terms of mergers and agency consolidations, we've been talking about that, but expanding that list. One of the things I want to mention is that if we are able to do any education fund restoration, that I'd like in our conference, I think, as a starting point, would like to see that money directed to those school districts that have a combined wealth ratio of under one, because our poorest districts right now are feeling the biggest pinch statewide. I think we're going to have an honest and open dialogue if we can get our public employee unions to return to the negotiating table in the spirit of a good collective bargaining process, because we have to look at holding off pay raises. We have to look at the size of our workforce across the state. And just a recent example of that is we provided testimony provided by the correctional officers across the state over the last year. The correctionals commissioner even admitted that maybe it's time for them to look at some of their overheads and employment levels that they have at the administrative area. And there's a lot of things that we can look at. We have to begin those discussions now. Both the majorities have come out with their framework for discussion. Obviously, the other day, that our conference is not in favor of borrowing up to $2 billion, but we also believe that we've provided an alternative list for discussion this weekend that we will provide, and hopefully there will be serious back-and-forth discussions about what those ideas can bring or not bring in terms of savings and revenue generation without resorting to any taxes at all or any borrowing at all. And I know that Lieutenant Governor Ravitch said he felt that we couldn't close the budget deficit without borrowing being on the table. And my main point is I think that should be a step of a last resort. And I think we're going to have plenty of time in the next few days and week to really discuss, hopefully openly with the staffs and conferences about these ideas. We're anxious to work together. We'll probably not agree on the entire list. But certainly I think what we would appreciate is an honest review and thoughtful response as to why they may or may not work, just as well as that's what we're providing to both the majorities and the governor as his budget proposals. We're anxious to move forward. We'll work. We'll show up. Let us know when it's going to be, but we will start, from our side, is provide that list today. So with that, we're anxious to get going.
Thank you, Assemblyman. And as you know, we have always extended an invitation to you and the conference to make recommendations and participate in legislation with us in a bipartisan fashion, and that invitation continues to this day. Okay. Having no further comments, I would make a motion to adjourn this meeting of the Joint Conference Committee, and reconvene when it is deemed appropriate. Hearing no objection, this meeting is adjourned.